sisters in the Lord. We're so glad to have you here with us. Let's begin with the greeting. I'll say, the Lord be with you, and then you all at home say, and also with you. If someone's next to you, turn to them and say it to them. So let's begin. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Wonderful. Let's begin with a moment of silent prayer where we prepare our hearts for worship in the Lord. Our first song for today is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, number 581 in the Red Psalter Hymnal. Joyful, Joyful, 581. Continue with the Ten Commandments, God's perfect standard for how we are called to live our lives. Exodus chapter 20 says, "And God spoke all these words, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. This is the law of the Lord." Let us now continue about Christ's perfect fulfillment of that law. Let's sing with the song, In Christ Alone, number 770 in the Red Psalter Hymnal. Continue with the prayer of God's people. Please join with me as we go before our Father and to his presence of love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you because you have promised to always receive us, to accept us, and to hear out our every prayers, even, Lord, if they may be unworthy. We thank you because of Jesus, your Son, who has given us this great privilege, extended unto us the love that you give him, so much so that we are co-heirs with him, so much so that we are acceptable and even welcomed in your sight, in your very holy presence. And so, O Lord, we lift up before you the needs of the people. We thank you, Father, for the many people in our congregation, in our community, who have gotten sick and yet recovered. And yet, O Lord, there are still some who are still struggling with illness, some who are struggling with loss. We pray especially, Lord, for Randy Jacobsma's family, a beloved member, a beloved father, husband, a beloved grandfather. And yet, O Lord, you chose in your wisdom to call him to your presence. May we, Father, have faith and confidence that he is now more at peace, more blessed than ever before. And yet, O Lord, please grant his family peace and tranquility. Grant them strength as they grieve. We also lift up before you other people of our community. We think of Trevor Krugman, and the cancer that he is battling with. Lord, we request that if it is your will, that you may continue to watch over him in such a way that all of the cancer will be undone and nothing to fear will ever return. We lift up before you also Jewel Hoffman and the cancer that she has battled with. Lord, grant your grace, grant your healing. We also wish to pray, O Lord, for the people who are serving in the military. We pray especially for Travis Zevenbergen, and we ask that although he is still in training, he will have enough rest, enough strength, enough of everything he needs, Lord, to get through it all and come back in peace and more blessed than before. We thank you for those who are perhaps even overseas right now, giving so much of a sacrifice of their time, strength, perhaps even health, even some who may give their lives for the freedom that this nation enjoys. Please bless them, Lord. Be with them. Even those who do not know your name, Lord, extend unto them your grace, and especially extend unto them, Lord, the opportunity for them to hear your gospel and believe with all their heart. We thank you, Lord, that in our community we have seen so little developments of this virus that has devastated the world. We thank you, Father, because it could be so much worse. We thank you, Lord, that the weather is coming around so that, Lord, we do not have to fear illness as much as before. But, Lord, we still pray for your protection. We pray, Father, that you may still help us, not just in the matters of our health, but also in the matters of the economy, so that not many jobs shall be lost, so that not many people shall be without means to provide for their families and food for their children. We pray, Father, for those who make decisions over us. We pray, Lord, for the health experts. We pray for the politicians, the governors, mayors, and our president. Give them all wisdom. And may their decisions not just be wise ones, but also may the implementation of their decisions be wise and well done. Most of all, Lord, we lift up your church, that though so many have not gone to church for so long because of this illness, we pray, Lord, that we will not grow lax, but we will remember our duties unto you, that we will still worship you on Sunday, though nobody is watching, that we will still worship you with all our hearts, still remember our duties unto you. Bless us now, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. Let us pray. Father, we ask that your Spirit will work amongst us as we hear your word. May it bless us, may it teach us, lead us, and guide us. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our passage for today comes from Matthew chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Matthew chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. And it says the following. After Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in the towns of Galilee. When John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, "Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?" Jesus replied, "Go back and report to John what you have heard and seen. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Blessed is the man who does not fall away on account of me." As John's disciples were leaving, Jesus began to speak to the crowd about John. "What did you go out into the desert to see? A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who wear fine clothes are in king's palaces. Then what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'I will send my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way before you.' I tell you the truth, among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. This is the word of the Lord. Prison can weigh heavily on a man. For John the Baptist, prison must have truly weighed heavily on him. John was a man of God's word. He loved the Lord, his God, very much. For years, he lived in the desert, preached God's word, his holy message. For years, he was convinced that what he was doing was indeed the will of God, the right thing to do. But now, if we can follow what the text is leading us, implying, we can just imagine that in his cold, lonely jail cell, John had too much time on his hands. And so he reflected, as anyone in prison would. We could just imagine him there sitting down with his elbows resting upon his thighs and his eyes peering down at his feet, remembering the past, remembering details, remembering past sermons that he had given, remembering the teachings about the coming Messiah that he himself proclaimed, and how great this chosen one of God would be. Reflecting on the first time he saw Jesus, remembering the voice from heaven he heard, and the Holy Spirit that descended upon Jesus on his baptism in the form of a dove. We can also imagine that John must have struggled with the fact that he was now in prison. It must have in one way or another weighed heavily on him, for as we all know, he was without a doubt an innocent and righteous man. And so maybe John would question in his prayers why the Lord allowed him to end up there. Maybe it bothered John. Maybe it even angered him at times. As I said before, prison can weigh heavily on a man. And then there were the reports of Jesus of Nazareth, which he heard from his own disciples, John's disciples. And this must have been a difficult thing for John to listen to, because these reports must have varied. Perhaps John overheard the prison guards, for example, talking to one another about a Nazarite, a Galilean, who was stirring up the crowds. He's one of those crazy men, they said, the kind that goes around proclaiming nonsense and brewing up all sorts of trouble. It's only a matter of time, I think, before he stirs up trouble against himself from the Roman government and they end up crucifying him. There must have been all sorts of conflicting, contradictory stories of Jesus, which John heard in prison. Some were good, but most certainly some were also bad. Some probably misunderstood what Jesus was teaching and saying. And so over time, the text implies that John began to second guess himself. Our text implies that perhaps in one occasion, as John was listening to his disciples tell a story of what one of the teachings Jesus gave, they spoke of how the crowds, for instance, followed Jesus, called him the Messiah, wanted to crown him king, when all of a sudden Jesus pushes them away with his words when he says, "I am the bread of life, and unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you have no life in you." We can just imagine, brothers and sisters, that after hearing such stories and conflicting reports, that John might have even asked himself, if he is the Messiah, then why is he doing all of these confusing things? Why would he push away the people of Israel when they are starting to rally around him, about to crown him king even? Why does he push them away? What is going on with this Jesus of Nazareth? I must ask him. And so John sends his disciples to Jesus. And you see, brothers and sisters, this is something that we can most certainly learn from. Sometimes, dear friends, there are doubts. And in the scriptures, we need to examine what these doubts mean. In other words, sometimes our faith is under fire, is tried, and gone through tribulation. It's put to the test. And really the best thing that we can do is examine these doubts and examine them with scripture for clarity, just as Jesus answered with scripture for clarity and for the sake of John the Baptist. Personally speaking, I remember a case in my own life. As many of you may know, I was raised up in the Christian faith by a Christian family, but there came a time in my youth, when I had many questions. I wondered if the Bible was true or if what the textbooks in my public school taught were true, and we actually did come from monkeys. I had all these questions about my own faith and about scripture and its truth. I wondered if the miracles recorded in the Bible could actually be true. Could water be turned to wine? Or was the Bible lying? Could the dead be raised? Or was it all just a gross exaggeration? So in order to find answers, I went down to a Christian bookstore, and I remember the first book I bought on apologetics, or a book about the defense of the faith, teaching of why the Bible is true. The name of the book was The Case for Faith by Lee Strobel, a very popular, famous book. And in it, I found so many good answers to the personal questions I had of my own faith. I remember questioning whether or not we came from evolution, for example, and in the book it talked about how there's no evidence for evolution in any museum anywhere. There are no bones which corroborate or support the idea that we descended from monkeys, although there are some very stupid professors which I would maybe perhaps believe they came from monkeys. It just wasn't there, the evidence. And that is why evolution is still a theory. There were so many questions which this book and other books answered well about my faith. But brothers and sisters, when you have that great doubt in your mind, then you must take the first step as John the Baptist did and examine your doubts. Examine them in the light of scripture. Do your homework, your research. You can't leave these things on the back burner, because then with time they will only grow worse, and eventually your faith may falter because you allowed these doubts to fester and grow. And I say this type of thing especially for the benefit of our youth, those who are young in our church or elsewhere. Many of you, when you eventually go off to college, especially if it's one that is a state college, a public college, you will be confronted with God-hating men and women. Literally, you will run into professors that will do or say almost anything if it makes you fall from your faith. They have no reserve on how low they will stoop. They will question the Bible in their classes for hours. They will cast all sorts of doubts, bring up all sorts of teachings and arguments. And believe me, dear friends, when you are surrounded by this propaganda, when you are terribly outnumbered by your fellow students who are God haters as well, your faith can start to waver. You will start to question the teachings of Scripture after a while, especially if you're quite young and new to your own decisions and where you stand. But my dear friends, don't just leave it at that. Don't just let your faith be questioned and beat about. Let people plummet it to the ground. No, do something about those doubts. Search through the scriptures. Search through books that have wisdom and good teachings in them. Find out the reason for the belief in the faith which you so dearly are entrusted with by your parents, as Paul first said to Timothy. And why should you do this? Young people, I want you to think of it this way, and this advice may come in handy for you sometime in the future in other areas. Why should you do this? Look into the matter yourself instead of just listen to your professors. But let's think of it this way. If you are, for example, a young lady and you are interested in dating or courting a certain young man, well then, what do you do? Do you send over a friend or a family member to talk to him about you and tell him what type of person you are, introduce you, or would you send over an enemy? Do you send someone that will only point out the bad in you, or do you send someone who may even lie about you and exaggerate and just try to make you look like a monster? And what if, young ladies, this young handsome man was only surrounded by your enemies? What type of picture would he get of you? What would happen as time went on? I tell you what will happen. The longer he stays around your enemies, those who misrepresent you, the more of a horrible and monstrous picture he will have of you. And dear friends, I tell you the truth that the more you also are around those God-hating men and women, the more of them that are in your life and the more time you spend with them, well, then the worse your understanding of God will be. It's just unwise. And this is why, dear friends, you have to be wise like John the Baptist, and don't just leave things as they are. Cut out the middleman. Investigate for yourself. Throw yourself into scriptures and the presence of God. Get to know your Lord. Don't just rely on the word of his enemies, for you will surely get the wrong picture. Take action. Don't listen to rumors and accusations, because the devil can mislead you to believe all sorts of horrendous lies about your Lord and Savior. And unfortunately, however, this wasn't John's only problem where he had doubts, and he eventually resolved it by investigating himself. But John also, according to the text, struggled with something else, something that you and I can easily struggle with. He was wrestling with something that is often wrestled with today. The text doesn't say it directly, but the greater context and the way Jesus answers John the Baptist sheds light upon what John also wrestled with. What was it that John struggled with? It was his concept of who the Christ should be, who God should be. In a sense, I can say he made God into his own image of what he thought God should be like. Why do I say this? Well, let's look at the larger context. In Matthew chapter 3, we hear John preaching about the one to come, that is Jesus the Christ. John says in verses 11 through 12, "As for me, I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is to come after me is mightier than I, and I am not fit to remove his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." He will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. In short, brothers and sisters, John knew that the Messiah was one that would set things straight. He would put God's house in order. He would bring justice and righteousness. He would judge wickedness and bring about shalom. And this idea is not unique to John the Baptist, but is written all over the Old Testament in the prophecies of the Christ. For example, Isaiah 35 verse 4, it says, "Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance. With divine retribution, he will come to save you." And yet, the story of Jesus, what was going on at that time, he was not going around and bringing about God's judgment. Jesus wasn't going around and calling down fire from heaven as Elijah did upon the hypocrites and the liars of Israel. He wasn't enforcing justice upon the unrighteous Pharisees, at least not in a way that seemed fit with John's idea of burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. No, instead, this Jesus of Nazareth went around town eating with prostitutes and tax collectors. He was cleansing lepers and proclaiming forgiveness to sinners. He was what? Proclaiming forgiveness and not judgment. What kind of Messiah is that? What about God's vengeance, his justice, his purity? And so John's doubts crept up. Maybe I made the wrong call. And he sent his disciples to ask him, "Are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else?" And Jesus answers in verses 4 through 5, "Go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame are able to walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor." Now the answer which Jesus gives to John is very important because it quotes certain passages from certain contexts. Earlier I read from Isaiah 29 concerning the vengeance of the Lord. Well, this is where Jesus also quotes from in his answer to John that he is indeed the Messiah. And this is what the text says in its full entire context. Isaiah 35 verses 4 through 6. "Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then will the eyes of the blind be opened and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then the lame will leap like a deer and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness and streams in the desert." Remember, John is the voice of one in the wilderness. Now the other text which Jesus quotes from is Isaiah 61. He quotes from two texts in his answer, and it says something similar about God's vengeance as well. It says, "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captive and release from the darkness for the prisoner." Something that John was in, right? Prison. "To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of God's vengeance, to comfort all who mourn." Once again, vengeance, yet at the same time, freedom and healing. Once again, Jesus said to John that the good news is being preached to the poor, but in the text which Jesus quotes from, we find that it also speaks of the year of God's vengeance. And brothers and sisters, I want to make clear to you that there is indeed a year of God's vengeance that is to come, that will never be undone, the day of judgment. And I would implore all of you to flee from it, anyone who has not truly taken that step in heart. Please flee from the wrath that is to come and take refuge in Christ, because there will indeed be a day when God judges the whole of the earth. He'll judge every single man, every single woman, and find them either guilty of the fires of hell or worthy of the gates of heaven because they stand in Christ. But the character of God, the love of God towards us, is so great that God, instead of just bringing down the hammer on our guilty heads, sends out his Son first and has delayed his return, in a manner of speaking, so that the good news, the gospel, may first spread upon the entire earth to every nation, people, tongue, and tribe. And this is why Jesus turned out so different from what John the Baptist first preached in the beginning of the gospel of him, and probably what John also really thought the Messiah would be like, the hammer of justice. This is why Jesus turned out so differently. And this too teaches us something very important, dear friends. It teaches us that sometimes Scripture teaches that which is difficult to accept. Sometimes Scripture teaches that which is very hard to swallow. Yet the law of God's authority must be obeyed. And what this means, brothers and sisters, is that sometimes there are things in the scriptures that may even offend us, things that we don't like or may even hate. But as God's law says, you shall not make for yourself an image of God. You should not take him and liken him to what you think he should be like, act like, and look like. Brothers and sisters, we are called to follow God, surrender all to him, and listen to him instead of our own ideas of what is right and wrong. Now, I want to end on a good note for John the Baptist, because I very much view him as a hero of the faith, although he had these struggles, and this is how Jesus also viewed him. For Jesus himself says in verse 7 to John, as John's disciples were leaving, he began to speak to the crowd. What did you go out into the desert to see? And he's talking about John. A reed swayed by the wind? If not, what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes? No, those who wear fine clothes are in the king's palaces. Then what did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, I will send my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way before you. Jesus began with the question, what did you go all the way out into the desert on foot in the hot sun to see out there? Was it a reed swayed by the wind, a man that is, that changes according to popular opinion, a people-pleasing pastor who likes to say whatever he sees the people like the most? Someone that will change his moral convictions in an instance if it makes him more popular on TV or acceptable to everyone else? No, of course not. John was nothing like that. Well, then what did you go out to see? A man dressed in fine clothes, someone with charisma and authority that people look to and really admire and immediately want to follow? No, you went out to see a prophet. Why? Because a prophet doesn't care about those things. He only answers to God and is swayed by no one. Indeed, this is God's messenger that was sent to prepare the way. And in the same way, brothers and sisters, I hope that you will also follow this wisdom and not be swayed by the ways of popular opinion about God. How can I believe in a God that would send someone to hell? That you will not make for yourself an image of what you think God should be like. How can I believe in a God who doesn't just forgive everyone and anyone? But rather, my hope for you is that you will be as wise as John was, who, when he had his doubts, he went against the influence of the world. He wrestled with these things using scripture, speaking to Jesus himself, examining and taking all the right steps, as we all should. And dear friends, sometimes we have to accept scripture despite its difficult teaching on who God is or what he wants from us. Sometimes we have to resist the influence and pull that this world will have upon us and stick to our convictions, even if the government makes it illegal for us to practice certain things of our faith. And sometimes, dear friends, we have to be willing to act like John, yes, and even go to prison for what we believe. Yes, that is right. We may even have to go to jail. And brothers and sisters, when we think of Jesus, when we think of the Messiah who was to come, who has already come but shall return, the one who opened the eyes of the blind and set the captives free, when you think of Jesus, especially you young people who will eventually have to make a choice for your faith, I ask you, what will you believe when you struggle, when you run into a road bump? What will you choose to do when you find yourself wrestling with your faith? My prayer is that you will not make God into your own image of what you think he should be, but instead reach out, learn from him, his wisdom, those who are his friends, read and learn from the scriptures. Brothers and sisters, My prayer for you is that you will not waver, but make the right choice when you find yourself in doubt and in difficult circumstances. Let us pray. Father, we thank you because your word is good and wise. And we wish to surrender, Lord, all our preconceptions, all of the things that we would put before you, and instead put you before us, so that we may follow, listen, and believe the way that you would have us believe. Bless us this day so that these words may have true impact in us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's now continue with the song, I Surrender All, number 739 in the Red Psalter Hymnal. I Surrender All, 739. Receive now the blessing of the Lord. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you his peace. Amen.